Good morning. As for what is sown on good soil, this is the person who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. It's great to have you with us this morning. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to all of you. We appreciate your presence and your prayers with us throughout today. We hope this service will be a blessing to you until we can gather together in person, which we always look forward to. Do want to share just a few things with you this morning. First of all, to say that the sympathy of the congregation is with Sandy Franklin and Dave and the family in the loss of Sandy's mother, Louise DeCorpo. They are traveling to Massachusetts to return her to her home, and our love and support are with the Franklin family, all the relatives and those who will gather there. We do proclaim together as a people of faith that death is swallowed up in victory, and we claim that for Sandy and her family today. We also claim that for Kevin Ford and his family. Kevin also this week lost an uncle, and so we continue to keep those members of our church family in prayer. This coming Tuesday, I want to invite you to join with me at 10 a.m. or at 6 p.m. for Cathy Chat. If you will call the church office and get some simple instructions for tuning in, I would love to be with you for a brief time, either of those times, and I would love for you to see some of our church family, any others who may want to join us. Please just call the office, talk with Susan, she'll give you the details. I look forward to seeing some of you at least on Tuesdays. And also I want to let you know that on Wednesday at 7 p.m., there will be a midweek, very brief worship service, mostly a time of prayer and listening. I'm calling it Christ Connect. And I hope you will tune in on our website, just like you do for the Sunday morning services. Tune in and receive some spiritual food, 7 o'clock on Wednesday. I appreciate all of you. I miss you. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
with me now responsively in our call to worship. Creator God, by your strength you established the mountains. You are girded with might. You silence the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, the tumult of the peoples. You visit the earth and water it. You greatly enrich it. The river of God is full of water. You provide the people with grain, for so you have prepared it. The pastures of the wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy. Let all things praise the Lord. We come together to share that with one another, most of all to share it with God, trusting in God's forgiveness. Let us join together and pray. We know the seeds we have sown, God. Our anger lives just below the surface and sometimes explodes in hurtful ways. Our bitterness is tucked within, but seeps out in cynicism and constant critique. Attitudes of fear and distrust linger in our hearts from wounds not healed. We want to reap free and joyful spirits, but the seeds we've sown can't produce what's not been planted. Help us grow deeper roots in you, that our sowing might bring forth a transformation of body, mind, and soul, for Jesus' sake. Let us continue our prayer in silence. Amen. We do not have because we do not ask. We sometimes need to be reminded to ask God for all that we need. We do so today. We ask for God's forgiveness, for God's mercy, for the opportunity to begin again, cleansed, healed, restored. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Hey guys, glad you could join us today. Hope you're okay. I know you're enjoying being outside in the summer, even though it's hot, but I know you're having a good time. And we're having a pretty good time here at church too, but we do miss you an awful lot. Let's talk for just a minute about prayer, just little prayers. You know, there's three basic answers to prayer. There's lots more, but there's just three. When you ask God for something, or Jesus for something, like we all do every day, he can say no, he can say yes, or he can say, let's wait a little while. Now, there's more things he can say, but that's kind of the basics, because, you know, when I was a kid, I kind of remember, well, I prayed for a new bike, or I prayed for a new saw, and God didn't answer the prayer. Yes, he did. He said, let's wait. Or maybe he just said no. Now, we're always asking Jesus for something. I know I am, and you probably do too. So instead of always asking, I kind of do it different. I certainly ask for forgiveness, and I ask to help us during this kind of tough time out here with you know, this virus going on. It's kind of rough. So I like to do things. I like to thank him. And I learned a long time ago, I'm one of these people that does a lot of prayers at night, but I do prayers all day long on just little silly things. I like to build birdhouses, and if a nail goes in just right, I like to look up and say, thank you, Jesus, because he helped me. If I'm mowing the grass and it looks pretty, thank you, Jesus. He loves to hear thank you probably more than he wants to hear us ask. So that's a thought. Oh, I bet you're wondering what this bird's doing over here. And he's drinking, isn't he? Yes, he is. Now, that little bird I had at my house yesterday, and I put him in front of his water yesterday morning. And when I went to bed last night, he was still drinking, but the water never went down. Now, what's that mean? I tell you what it means. This water is the love of Jesus that I don't care how many times you ask him something, he'll always give you an answer. Just like this glass, he'll pretend like he's drinking all day long, but the water stays the same. That's the love of Jesus. He stays the same, just like this crazy little bird. Okay, do me a favor. You know we're online, so you can watch us every Sunday or anytime you want to. Invite a friend. I know all you guys have buddies and friends and so forth, because coming up, we're going to have all sorts of interesting children's messages. We're going to talk about hammers one of these Sundays. We may talk about saws one of these Sundays. And we're going to talk about all sorts of things. Invite someone to watch. And then, when we open the building, they may come and be with you. Wouldn't that be great? And you need to understand that the adults are saying, well, church is open, but the building's closed. Because the church is right here in your heart. That's where the church is. I love every one of you, and I'll pray for you. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye.
Great thou art. morning. The gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 13, 1 through 9, and then 18 through 23. The parable of the sower. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them. Other seeds fell on the rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. But other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." And then 18 through 23, the parable of the sower explained. "Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the words of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what's sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises, on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word and yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100, in another 60, in another 30. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be.
The sower in Jesus' parable that Charlie just read for us, who was no doubt also the farmer, went out to sow. The seed that he was sowing would have been carefully hand-selected from the best of the previous season's seed. It would have been carefully stored and protected from the damp and from insect infestation. After tilling the soil and preparing it for sowing, the sower would have waited for the optimum weather conditions and then on the right day gone out to sow. Farmers nowadays have tractors that will plow perfectly spaced rows and additional equipment that will drop seeds in perfectly spaced lines. Corn and soybeans grow in abundance from this method. If you're a gardener, you too can plant seeds in perfectly spaced rows, perfectly spaced apart, if you want to take the time to do that. If you have a large area, you can broadcast the seed and risk where the plants will come up. Some seeds are stubborn about their growing conditions, and some seeds have a lot of tenacity. Their plants will come up in sidewalk cracks or mountain slopes. The seed in Jesus' parable didn't have a great success rate. There's an old adage that states, "One for the mouse, one for the crow, one to rot and one to grow." 3 out of 4 of the places where the sower sowed seed did not produce any fruit. Some was wasted immediately as the birds ate the seeds from the path, and they had no chance to germinate. Other seeds began to grow, but after a short time, that on rocky ground, or a longer time, that among the thorns, they did not reach full maturity. Whether we're hearing this parable for the first time, or whether we've heard it before, the point that is frequently taught asks, so what kind of soil are you? Are you bringing in the best harvest from all that God has invested in you? That thinking focuses on the soil. If the soil is good, the harvest will be plentiful. Those who hear the word and understand and receive it will yield much fruit. Here are a couple other points to consider. Those who hear and don't understand. Those who hear and have it snatched away. Those who hear and have no roots or get choked. Why is that? Perhaps this parable is pointing to not only whether we're good or bad soil, but also who around us has obstacles in their way. Do we dig in other places, get our hands dirty, pulling up roots and rocks and weeds so that Jesus' seed can grow there with a harvest to follow? And finally, what's surprising in this parable is not that 3 out of 4 seeds didn't grow, but that the sower spread so much of it everywhere. A poor farmer could only eke out a living for himself and his family if he made wise choices about where to sow, and he was blessed with good weather. The wise farmer would make sure to entrust the precious grain he had to the best soil. But this farmer, this sower, tossed seed out everywhere with great abandon. This sower behaved as if that which was most precious was available in unlimited supply. And to top it off, a sower like this was blessed beyond anyone's wildest dreams. Normally, the farmer who reaps a twofold harvest would be considered fortunate. A fivefold harvest would be a cause for celebration throughout the village, a bounty attributable only to God's particular and rich blessing. But this foolish sower, who in a world of scarcity casts his seed on every kind of soil, is blessed by God in shocking abundance. A harvest of 30, 60, 100-fold what he sowed. In this time of uncertainty and unrest, it's tempting to hold on to what we've got, to guard closely what's precious. Good and responsible stewardship tends to give only to those we're sure are worthy, and protect our resources like the last eggs of the rarest endangered bird. We're anxious and fearful for ourselves, about when the next shoe will drop and what it will cost us. God's people have been entrusted with that which is most precious in the world. But ironically, these priceless commodities only gain value. The seed of God's word only bears fruit when we are willing to get rocks, thorns, and other obstacles out of the way for our neighbors. When God's people scatter that seed absolutely heedless of who is worthy to receive it. Listen, we are called to treat God's love, God's justice, and God's blessing, precious as these are, as if they were absolutely limitless in supply for one simple reason. They are. Will you join with me now in stating from the Confession of 1967 what it is we believe? God's redeeming work in Jesus Christ embraces the whole of our life, social and cultural, economic and political, scientific and technological, individual and corporate. It includes our natural environment as exploited and despoiled by sin. It is the will of God that God's purpose for human life shall be fulfilled under the rule of Christ, and all evil be banished from God's creation. Biblical visions and images of the rule of Christ, such as a heavenly city, a father's house, a new heaven and earth, a marriage feast, and an unending day, culminate in the image of the kingdom. The kingdom represents the triumph of God over all that resists God's will and disrupts God's creation. Already, God's reign is present as a ferment in the world, stirring hope in all and preparing the world to receive its ultimate judgment and redemption. With an urgency born of this hope, the church applies itself to present tasks and strives for a better world. It does not identify limited progress with the kingdom of God on earth, nor does it despair in the face of disappointment and defeat. In steadfast hope, the church looks beyond all partial achievement to the final triumph of God. Shall we join our hearts in prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for limitless amounts of your grace and your mercy, for your justice and your peace. And we know that you want all of that for all of your children. So help those of us who profess to know that, to claim that. Help us, Lord, to scatter those seeds around us with great abandon. Lord, help us to be about the work of removing barriers to people living a life of wholeness and fullness. God, we know that all of creation is groaning, waiting for redemption. And we see signs of that every day. We too, Lord, wonder in this time of uncertainty. We wonder, God, sometimes where your spirit is moving. Help us to trust that you are present, that even when we feel depressed and defeated, that we have an everlasting hope in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who holds us together as a body of believers, who gives us strength and nourishment for every day, whose seeds are constantly bearing fruit within us. It is in his name that we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we live out each day with unknowns, with the inability to plan, with separation from those we love, may we continue in our own way to trust that the abundance of God's grace is upon us, that we can scatter all around us God's seeds of grace and love, and that we can ourselves work on the soil, to remove barriers for others, to make it good and rich for our own growth. And may the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ our Lord, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen.